Hey guys, Brigitte here with San Diego Seed Company, and we are doing video number two. All things you need to know about beginner irrigation setup, okay? We have video number one. If you haven't seen that, I recommend hopping over, checking that out, because I will explain all the different terms I'm going to use so it doesn't sound like I'm speaking in German, you know what I'm talking about. And it gives a quick overview of what we're gonna accomplish right now. So check out video number one first if you want to. Otherwise, let's jump into it. I'm actually gonna put together a quick irrigation system that you can totally use on a patio, in a backyard, in a raised garden bed. It doesn't matter. It could even be school gardens, anywhere. The system will work, and it is a great beginner system that you can build on over time. Now don't forget to like and subscribe so you're notified anytime we put out a video that's gonna help you become the best and most successful grower you can be. Okay, so I've got tons of parts around me, and trust me, I don't like irrigation. It's like my least favorite part about gardening, but if you're in zone 9 and 10, it's essential. We live in a semi-arid climate. It's hot, it's dry. Water is extremely precious, and it's vital to our survival and to the survival of our gardens. So it should be the place where you invest your time and energy to make it super efficient and consistent so your plants can thrive. The only way you can do that is with irrigation. Hand watering doesn't cut it. I don't care how regular you are and how careful you are, you just simply can't have a really thriving garden that pumps out tons and tons of produce if you're hand watering. The other great part about irrigation is you can go on vacation, come home, and have a billion tomatoes to eat, right? Because it's getting irrigated. So let's hop into how you do it. This is a hose bib. This is where the water comes off of your house. Depending on your garden setup, you might have a hose bib in your garden, but most people in a city setting will probably have a hose bib that actually comes off the water pipes from inside their house, okay? A couple things to note about this. Because this is coming from city water and not well water, it tends to be a little bit cleaner, right? Because this is the same water that we drink. So there are some things that you don't necessarily have to do that you would need to do if you're using like well water in a more farm setting, and I'll get into those details. But basically, this is a hose bib where the water actually comes out. This is called a splitter. Now, splitters come in tons of different sizes. This is just two of them. I've had splitters where there's actually four valves that come off of it, which is really great. If you only have one water source, and let's say you're renting, obviously you're not gonna put a hole in the house and get another pipe to come out, so you just have to split the water off as many times as you can. For us on this property, we've got a bunch of different locations where water's coming off, so I'm just splitting it into two because I want a regular hose bib so I can, you know, hose off my bike or whatever, and then another hose bib from the splitter that is dedicated to the system. So part number one from this system that's really important is called a timer. I talk about this in video number one, lots of different brands. We really like Orbit because they come with 100% guarantee. So if at any point this conks out, you can put in a support ticket with them and they will send you a new one. Or I think they send you a code, then you get the, you know, you put the code in, they send you one free, basically. But it's rad because things happen, technology breaks, whatever. These are not super inexpensive, especially if you're gardening on a budget. So you wanna know that it's backed by a guarantee, which Orbit is. This is a very basic timer that you can control with these knobs. Super simple to figure out. It's battery powered. So stick a battery in the back. And it works for most gardeners in zone 9 and 10 because as long as it's kept above freezing. So if you were in a really, really cold place, you know, most people in 9 and 10 aren't, this will work perfectly fine. If you were gardening in zone 5, you would want to take this off in the fall and put it in your garage or somewhere because the extreme cold temperatures will destroy it. So it's something to consider. So this is part number one that's extremely important. Now I'm gonna give you a pro tip right here. You guys seen this stuff here? This is called plumber's tape, and it's a very, very thin tape that you use to put around the threads of any threaded connection, and it will make all the difference as far as the seal goes, which means you're not gonna have leaks. You really don't want a leak right next to your house or really anywhere in your garden because water is expensive. But if we had a leak here and it was constantly leaking, I could do a lot of damage. Particularly if you're renting something, you don't want to get in trouble, right? So you want to make sure every connection is really secure. Because we have very mineral water in Southern California specifically, connections can really get destroyed pretty quickly. So this is one of the things that we use. Now, you can get this at Home Depot, very inexpensive. It's thread seal tape, or we just call it plumber's tape. You can get, you know, a pack of it. Love this stuff. So I'm actually gonna take off, we've got some old stuff on here, and I want that off. And I want that off because on it is little tiny pieces of sand and grit and things like that. And I want this to be a very clean, clear connection, okay? I want these threads to really be threaded very nicely with the other component. So I'm just going to take this, I'm gonna go around here. It's super thin, right? It's not like tape at all. I'm gonna go around, I don't know, 4 or 5 times. Not rocket science here, it doesn't have to be absolutely perfect, but the idea is this tape will basically fill in any tiny little threaded areas, and it's also going to keep the minerals, some of the minerals off of this metal piece. I think this is probably like brass, and over time, they just get destroyed. It's really quite a bummer. Okay, so it goes on the piece that you're gonna thread on. Next, I'm going to put on my timer. So notice the direction that I put this tape on. I put it clockwise because I'm going to turn this clockwise, and if I did it the other way, it would just come off, right? So you want the thread to stay on there and basically fill in these tiny little holes of the other thread that could potentially cause a leak, right? So I'm gonna put this on here. Now, a little plumber's tip here is if you ever have to force a thread, if you go to screw something on, it really doesn't feel right, stop. Assess and figure out, okay, is it a different, are the threads different? Is one of the threads broken? Because if you force it, then you're gonna have leaks later, right? So I actually always kind of go the back way first a little bit, and that's a pro tip I got from my friend John. Then I start the turn, okay? And that's just because it sounds ridiculous, right? It sounds like I'm being totally neurotic, but you really don't want this to leak, right? And you don't want to destroy those threads. You want it to go on nice and evenly, and you want it to be hand tightened. With something like this, you should never have to tighten it with a wrench, okay? It should be a hand tightened, easy, simple system here. Okay, great, so I've got that on. I'm not over tightening it. Because I put this thread on, or this tape on, I probably don't have to really, you know, over tighten it. I don't wanna break any of the pieces inside. Unfortunately, things are being made more and more economical. I'll say that word. And so they tend to break easily. So you wanna be gentle, right? Because this is our system. All right, so stand by as I put tape on the next two parts, and then we'll keep moving on here. Okay, so what have I done here? So this is called a pressure regulator. Very important, especially if you know the pressure off your house is really high, okay? This is a 30 PSI pressure regulator, which is what is recommended for this drip irrigation. Anytime you get a drip irrigation set or kit, they will recommend for you what it should be. As a general rule of thumb, on our farm when we're doing stuff, we're using T-tape, so we keep it even lower. But like in the garden setting where I'm using drip irrigation systems, I keep it around 30. Don't really want to go much higher than that because I don't want pieces blowing off and I don't want leaks and things like that. An important thing to know right here is it shows the flow, okay? So if you were able to put this on backwards, which would be very difficult because the threading's different, but it has happened, you can ruin the system because the water needs to flow through the pressure regulator at a certain direction. Because the regulator's up here, water comes out here at a higher pressure, it gets slowed down here, and then it goes into the system. So very, very important, okay? Now, if you're in a farm setting or using, well water, which we do on our farm, you would want something like this. This is called a filter. Basically, what this is doing is water's coming down, and it's going into this filter system, and it's keeping out minerals, all the things that you'll find that will clog up the fine, tiny little holes of emitters. What's really cool about this system is it's really easy to clean. You know, you just unscrew that, clean it out almost like you do like a dishwasher filter. And it also has a little bottom part where you can blast out extra particles that get stuck in there. So on a house setting, is this necessary? Not necessarily. We've never used one on our at our home garden because our water is pretty well filtered. We live in the middle of the city. On the farm, necessary. So you can make that decision. I'm not going to use one here because we haven't had a problem with clogging emitters. All hose bibs, standard hose bibs, are 3/4 inch. Important thing to kind of store in your memory bank there. This is going into a 1/2 inch feeder line, okay? Now, the top part here is threaded, right? You saw me screw that on. The bottom part of this is what's called a compression fitting. So kind of imagine it's kind of like, remember those like Chinese finger, whatever they call it? You know, you got them at like the fair. But basically, the inside of this is ribbed in a way that it, when you push a feeder line in, it will get stuck and it won't come out because it's like concave in there, if you can see inside that, right? That's called a compression fitting. Another important term to remember, because when you go to Home Depot or if you're shopping online, you need to know what kind of fittings to get. This is just a coupling just to show you how it works, but I want to show you something really important. This is my least favorite part about irrigation, is the compression fittings, because they're kind of a pain in the butt to get in, right? Your arms hurt because you're like using weird muscles. But basically, you got to try to get it in there. Over the years, I've learned a nice little trick, okay? Hold it like this, and instead of trying to really push it straight on, give it a little wiggle back and forth. You'll feel it get stuck, right? It'll start to grab. Then you just wiggle it on like this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, about 5 wiggles. And each time you can feel it catch. It's stuck in there, right? It's not coming out. Getting this off is really hard, which means when you go to undo things, it's a pain in the butt. Usually I have my husband pull these out because it drives me nuts. But these can be removed. So it's not a permanent system, which is one of the reasons why I love it. Let's say you decide actually one day you want a tee here, or you know, whatever, or you want to reuse this part. There, you know, you want to save them in your garden and reuse them. You don't want to buy new ones. This can come off. Again, you do the same type of system. Wiggle, 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 wiggle until you get it off. And you'll notice, give me a second here. Where's my husband when I need him? Ah, that's what happened, right? Because it was getting caught in this little compression part here. It's really important. So that's what a compression fitting is called, which is exactly what this is. Now here I have an elbow. These type of elbows are called barbed elbows. And the reason they are is because they have a little barb on them. You can see little barbs on it. That's how they catch it. Now in an irrigation setup, you can use a combination of both these and compression, right? They both work the same. What's the most important is that they're the same diameter, right? So they fit this line the same. Most of the times if you get standard setups, and also like if you're a brand new gardener, if you get a kit, they're all gonna be the same. So it kind of takes out that confusion, right? But here we have the barbed pieces, right? That got stuck on there. This one went under here, and then we went underneath the patio. And we did that because we don't want to trip on it, okay? For those of you who are pretty confident in the garden and can be pretty creative, this is really all you need to know. From here, it's just continuing to connect these pieces until you get to wherever you want the water to go, right? So to your raised bed, to your pot, to wherever you want to go. So you really can run with it from here. So for those of you who need a little more hand-holding, stick around for video number 3, because I'm going to go into exactly how you puncture holes in these, how you run water to different pots and things. So I'll actually run water to this, the different emitters. And the most important part of irrigation that I think everyone should know is a few key decision factors that you want to have when you're thinking about how to lay out the irrigation. Are you going to do one line? Are you going to do squigglies? Are you going to put the different emitters? I will go over the thought process. And keep in mind, there's no one size fits all. You can do things, everybody can do things a little bit different, and you can still accomplish the same goals. But over the years, I have learned a couple of tips that will make a big difference on how successful your crops are. So stick around and check out that video.